Hello, everyone. Welcome to Mixed Ink. This is the start of a new weekly series that we're going to be doing live stream. So I'm going to be here every Monday, 2:30 p.m. Eastern, listening to mixes and hopefully giving some useful feedback. I'm excited to hear everything that you guys have sent in. I saw that a bunch came in just recently, too. So I'll explain a little bit of what's going on for anybody who's watching that isn't familiar with pureMix or Mixed Ink. pureMix, awesome site for learning how to make records. You can check it out. There's some ad stuff over there. And we got you guys in live chat up here. And then Mixed Ink is this guy over here. And what it is pureMix Pro members can submit their mixes onto this platform for feedback from the community. And then sometimes we do these takeovers, which I'll be here every Monday. And we go through and try to leave helpful feedback for everybody. So the name of the game is helping everybody make better records. And it's a lot of fun. There's a lot of really amazing people in the community that leave feedback and help everybody out. So how we're going to do this is in Mixed Tank, we have a draw a track button during these takeovers, and that randomizes all the mixes that were submitted and selects one for review. So we found that that's the most fair way for us to try to get to everybody who submitted a track. And if we don't get to it today, first of all, there's an amazing group of people on there that will still comment on your track and give great feedback. There's people that are on there every day. Shout out to Tom Foolery. He's awesome. And it's super useful. And if we don't get to it today, then hopefully we can next week or the week after, or, you know, at one of these live streams. So I think with that said, let's dive right in. And I'm going to hit draw a track here. This one is Higher from Justin Lindeau. I'm totally butchering your name, and I'm sorry. He also says he's here to get roasted by me, but I don't roast, so.
Lying here with you, somehow the pieces fit together. Kind of reminds me of the summer, burning like
Awesome track. That was cool. Very nice, Justin. Great. So let's see. K Wright says Billie Eilish vibes. Yeah, it sounds freaking great. That's awesome. Everybody digs it in the chat. Cool. So I love the track. That was a professional production. Feels great. Just to go forward with like little comments I heard, this is all really nitpicky stuff because this track sounds awesome. Starting off with the acoustic guitar. So kind of this is going to be a little bit of a theme for me is this like depth thing. But the acoustic did kind of feel like it was sitting in front of the lead vocal a little bit, which can be a vibe. And that's cool. That's kind of where it comes down to taste, too. But I felt like it was a little thick in the low mid. So I'm thinking like maybe a little bit less like 200, 220, 160, like somewhere in that area, like cutting a little bit of that stuff might make some more room for that lead vocal to sit there. And yeah, that was basically it. It's a great sounding guitar and the performance is awesome. It's nice and articulate. The edge guitar that's kind of going on, giving that percussive vibe, that feels like it's really wide to me in the mix. So there's a lot of stereo widening going on and it's feeling a little bit phasey, which kind of gives me a swimmy feeling, which matches the vibe of the track, but it's also kind of pulling me out a little bit too. Whenever it comes in, it's really wanting itself to be heard. And again, I want to hear the song. So I want to hear the singer like always kind of delivering the message. Not that they should be the loudest thing all the time. For example, that Foo Fighters example. The Foo Fighters mix style that I mentioned earlier is amazing. So it's not always that the lead needs to be on front, but again, this song, I felt like she wanted to be close and giving me the message with this big ambient thing happening too. Overall things felt a little bit spread. Like the last chorus also kind of felt that way where it was really, really wide. I love the pre-chorus right before the final chorus there. And I feel like the vocal might've been de-essed a little bit heavily. So there was some articulation especially in like the last chorus, I was struggling to hear what she was saying and the actual words that were, you know, coming out. It felt like it might've just been tamed a little bit too much, or it needs a little bit of brightness. It could also be reverb that's kind of building up and getting muddy around her. Just too much of that stuff going on, but a little bit more presence in the vocal. Could be a little bit heavy in the low mids too, so maybe just playing with that a little bit. But this song is awesome, man. Sounds great. So yeah, thanks for submitting it. Very cool. I hope you guys heard me that time. All right. Cool. I'm going to draw a track here. Okay, we got Mi Kama. The song. Not sure if it's the song or the artist is Floaty. The user is Floaty. So Floaty, and this is Mi Kama. And says, hello, I recorded this in my room and I'm new to mixing. I've been mixing about 6 months. If you can give me some advice, I appreciate it. Let's see what we can do, Floaty. Here we go.
Ayer te estaba pensando y me acordé de ti. Me acordé de las locuras y cuando yo te hacía feliz. Ahora ya no estás, ¿y qué hago con todo el tiempo que perdí? Que perdí. Nada, me toca morderme solo en mi cama, pensando en tu sonrisa y en tu cara que me vuelve loco, loco. Ya no quiero nada, nada. Me toca morderme solo en mi cama, pensando en tu sonrisa y en tu cara que me vuelve loco, loco. Y ya no quiero nada. ¿Y qué hago con tu foto si la tengo guardada? Te pienso noche y día, yo ya no tengo paz en mi cabeza. Por favor regresa, que esta espera me desespera. Te quisiera volver a tener otra vez y decirte las cosas que yo te decía cuando te tenía. Cuando no había dañado la confianza que entre tú y yo había, pero ya la cagué y te dañé. Y ojalá pudiera devolver el tiempo pa' demostrarte que yo ya cambié. Pero nada, nada, me toca morderme solo en mi cama, pensando en tu sonrisa y en tu cara que me vuelve loco, loco. Ya no quiero nada, me toca morderme solo en mi cama, pensando en tu sonrisa y en tu cara que me vuelve loco, loco. Ella... Y quizá yo la cagué, quizá ya no te vuelva a ver. Y quizás esto es como un juego, yo ya estoy en el último nivel. Game over, ya la perdiste. Ahora con otro que ya sonríe, hay otro que la cuida como tú no lo hiciste. ¿Y yo qué? ¿Y yo qué? Nada, me toca morderme solo en mi cama, pensando en tu sonrisa y en tu cara que me vuelve loco, loco. Ya no quiero nada, me toca morderme solo en mi cama, pensando en tu sonrisa y en tu cara que me vuelve loco, loco. Ya no quiero nada.
Cool. Great job, Floaty. Yeah, that's awesome that you started 6 months ago and you're making productions and everything. So that's great. It's all part of the journey. And yeah, welcome to the fun and all that. And yeah, I assume you're a new pro member and everything. And yeah, thanks for signing up and being a part of this. So yeah, as a couple people pointed out in comments on here already, there's some vocal tuning things. And one cool thing, since you're a pro member and you were able to submit a mix, you get Melodyne Essential for free with your subscription. So while you're kind of getting pitch under your hat, so to speak, as a vocalist, Melodyne is a fantastic tool for chopping up vocals and making things fit better. And one thing that I actually really like about Melodyne is that it can help you tune your ear a bit. So it can, you know, moving notes around in a scale and kind of hearing things in a better position after, you know, you've done some finessing and all that, really trains your ear to hear pitch better as a whole. So it's something that could also help. I'm not sure if you're the vocalist on this. You recorded this song in your room, so I think that you are. It can help really train your ear, and you'll notice your natural pitch getting better. So yeah, overall, like, it's a great tool and it can help out a lot. One other thing that I do this with seasoned vocalists as well, before we sing a vocal, is we'll go out to a piano and I'll have them play the melody on the piano and sing along with it. And it's amazing how a lot of times vocalists won't think of their lines in a note format like that. So they'll figure out the notes, and then as they're singing it, you'll hear them kind of lock into the pitch of the piano. That's a really great vocal exercise too. Like, when you're practicing and becoming a better singer, if you figure out the notes on the piano that you're singing, sing along with it as you play them, again, it'll help train your ear for pitch. So that's something that I hope helps out a lot. Song-wise, I think the intro could probably be a little bit shorter, and same thing going on in the outro too. So we return to the chord structure at the end of the song, and it goes on. I'm not sure if that was like 4 or 8 bars there, but same kind of chord pattern, but there's not really any other elements that tell me this song has come to a close and the story that I was telling you is closing out. They're like, we need a climax at the end that kind of says like, that was the moment, whatever. So thinking in terms of song structure, if you're, you know, for example, if you're telling somebody the problem in verse one, and then you're giving them the hook, that's the main theme of the song, and then in verse two, maybe you're telling them how the problem's getting better. Chorus two, you're giving them the theme. In the bridge, you figured it out, it all got better. Chorus three is the big close, where like, now everything's happy and fine or whatever. So just throughout the song, I'd like to see a little bit more development of kind of the song going on. The other thing, vocal timing is another one that I heard going on in here that could be worked on. So you could sing along with the metronome, play an instrument with the metronome. Those things are all going to help you lock in a lot. And yeah, the other one might be that there could be too many words going on in the vocal as you're going on too. It felt like you're trying to rush through the syllables and get through it. So I think solving a lot of that stuff on the song level is going to help you put it together in a mix format a lot better. Mostly because it'll help you approach the mix with intention. You'll have like a idea of what was going on with each section of the song, what was the goal of each part of it, and it'll help you deliver that with the mix. So I hope that helps. Again, like, welcome to the party. It's awesome, and keep going. So cool. Let's draw another track. Confetti. Awesome. Okay. we have Cargo from the Patapoof. That's an awesome name. All right, so Patapoof is a passionate person in his level. So he's this track status is at Advanced Mix. He says, "Hey guys, it's me. First time I tried to fix the phase issue." So this is probably a track that he submitted before, got some feedback, put up a new version to check out. So we're going to do that. So he's been working on the vocal a bit. Let's check it out. Here we go.
On vient de débarquer 35 jours de galère et de nuit pour s'éviter. J'avance sur ce qu'est une vie sur brûle comme l'acide. L'enfer va commencer. Vieille chose et narguilée, schéma et tout oublié. L'alcool est mon allié. L'amour il faut payer. Vire et grâce, elle m'entraîne vers l'angoisse et la rengaine. J'en ai marre de ramer. La détresse a pollué l'océan de mes pensées. Les sept machines dans ma tête, machines sous des tempêtes. Les sept machines dans ma tête, la moitié.
Nice. I love hearing the stop at the end here. Or it might have been a guitar pedal. Sorry. That might have been a guitar pedal. That's awesome. Cool. Yeah. Thanks for submitting this. The Patapoof. So we got some great comments going in the chat here. Yeah. Very cool. Very cool stuff. So the first thing that kind of jumped out to me was the guitar on it. So the one that's happening, we'll go to the verse again. There's going along with the groove, it's kind of like some muted picking in between the line. And there are times that was actually pulling me out of the song. That was one of the things that was like drawing my attention to it, but a little bit too much. So again, like pulling me out of what is the message of the song. So sorry to like keep harping on that, but that's the biggest thing to me with any mix. It's like, we're trying to deliver the song instead of being impressive. So anything that like pulls me away from that, just getting the feel of it is something that like immediately tells me in a mix personally that might be something to look at. So yeah, the guitar, that's, it's kind of up the center in the verse too, like right with the vocal, which maybe like moving it off to the side a little bit would generate a little bit of space for that vocal to sit and live. The vocal in general felt like it could use a little bit more presence, but also a little bit more size too. So maybe something to look at, just kind of what's going on with that. I like, what comes to mind that I would kind of go to is like a Pultec of some sort, like whatever plugin you have, might be cool in small doses. But the kick drum felt like it needed a little bit more punch and present. It doesn't necessarily need to be super loud, but I felt like it needed to just kind of like have a little bit more push on it. So I don't know if there's like a lot of compression going on it, but maybe if you have a compressor on there, slow down the attack time a little bit and let some of that transient push through to punch me a little bit more. And the side wide guitars felt a little bit wide, but also a little bit, there was like a texture to them in that like 4K-ish range that felt a little bit gritty. Then maybe like some EQ, just kind of playing with that and seeing if you can get them to sit in a powerful way, but not overbearing way. So yeah, like removing some of that mud might give some more definition and allow you to get them a little bigger. Then there were a few timing things to check out, notably in that guitar that was doing some of the picking and kind of saying like, I'm the second thing you should be listening to a lot of the time. Just make sure that the timing's really tight with that. The groove's really important to just kind of stay there and be a good foundation. And yeah, otherwise I thought it was super cool. So yeah, thanks for submitting it. And I want to go back to that one that was before, because I had a comment that I forgot to mention. It was a production comment, and there were a couple times that you really emphasized the word loco loco. It was like two locos in the chorus, and that felt like a moment where you could like double and triple that and pan those out and actually get some moments happening in that song. So just wanted to go back and give that to you. Okay, awesome. Let me, as Andrew Shep says, let me pee on your wall. So I'm going to say Mark was here. And there's my link. Cool. All right, let's draw a new track. Here we go. Confetti. Okay, this is Just in Time from user 14124108079, who is passionate. Okay, and song's called Just in Time. No notes, let's check it out. Here we go.
些距离的相处，解析着每一次和你的日出，刻意的掩饰呵护，偷瞄忘记看路，你知晓我太糊涂，当一切都和天气转凉，风吹过了脸上不经意绕个弯就走的，当闲来无聊，当经过走桥，故意忘的方向是你真好。下一个有你的 起全亮，风吹过的脸上不经意绕个弯就走掉，当闲来无聊，当经过走桥，故意忘的方向是你正好，当我们都老，当时中停了，我用尽了全力奔向你，却再也追不上，就下次遇到告诉你这些走桥都是真好，故意忘的方向是你的方向。
Cool. Awesome job, man. User 12410807 29. Great job. I definitely dig it. Thanks for submitting it. Let's check out a couple things here that I made a note of. So first thing was, I love the bass in the beginning of it. That felt like nice and, you know, let me know that there was going to be like some nice like bottom to the track. The vocal feels a little bit too loud to me, and at first I was thinking it was a volume thing, but then I just kind of like, well, one, I brought my monitors down in here to kind of feel like if, you know, maybe I was just kind of had it up too loud, but brought things down and just kind of listening to like what kind of pokes out of the image with it, and the vocal actually felt like it was sitting in a fairly good spot, but it was so compressed that it feels loud, the same way that a mix can feel super loud at a quiet volume if you just blast the limiter, right? So overall, I think that the vocal's too compressed, and that causes it to get a little bit harsh at times. There's like S-ing and some bitey stuff that is kind of sneaking out of the compressor as it's letting go in relation to the body. So yeah, just overall, just a little bit too overcompressed. You might try doing some things in parallel compression instead of doing all of your compression right on top of the vocal. A random like shout out thing that I like. Thanks, John Paterno, for teaching me this one. Devil Lock in its default settings feels amazing. If you just have it, you know, send it, you know, to an aux, send your original vocal to an aux or make a duplicate, whatever. Put Devil Lock on it, default settings, and just kind of tuck that in under, and you can get that effect of like bringing the vocal closer to you without getting all of the extra, you know, SE harsh stuff that goes on from it. Yeah, it doesn't have to be decapitator either, just something that's, you know, kind of like packing the vocal down and then allowing you to blend it in naturally. Also with the vocal, I feel like it's, you know, very dry, which is can be part of the style, and that's totally cool. But there's some things that you could do to add a little bit of depth without making it sound overly affected. One thing I love doing is usually like I'll use Echo Boy or something, or some kind of delay around like a 16th, or, you know, the note value is like play with it until it feels right. But just again, tucking that under, not so that you hear the delay, but so that it brings the vocal forward, if that, you know, kind of makes sense. So not over compressing, maybe using some parallel compression, and then doing something to tell you that it's close to you by putting something behind it. So sorry for this. So again, it's kind of like that layered card thing that Fab talks about, where if I have my vocal here, I don't know it's here unless I know that there's something kind of back here or in front or whatever. Like I need context for it. So the delay can kind of treat that to give you that same effect of a loud vocal without having to do over compression. So nice tuning on the drums. I think that they sounded programmed, but they felt really well tuned, which was cool. I wanted to hear more of an event out of those times, like when the big fills happen, especially toward the end. Let's see, this would be around 250 or so. There's some really cool fills that you're pulling off there that I feel like those could be bigger. They could be bigger moments, and that could be, if you can't get them up, that could mean that your bus compression's biting down a little bit hard too. So just keep an eye on that. But yeah, making more of an event out of those times and like having them really come out and be like, we're going into the next section, it'd be really fun. So check that out. There was a timing thing with the bass when it entered the first guitar solo. I want to say that was around 1 minute or so. So just watch timing overall. Maybe just do another sweep through all of your production. Just kind of make sure everything's nice and tight. Yeah, and then other than that, you know, just sprinkle some effects in there on that vocal to taste. But again, it is taste, so if you totally dig the dry thing, that's okay too. Just maybe give some context behind it. So hopefully that helps. And I will drop my thing here. Mark was here. YouTube link. Let's draw another one. So let me know how you guys are doing in the chat too, by the way, like if you want to keep going for a little bit. We talked about making these like an hour long, but we want to get to as many tracks as we can, not just like three or four tracks each time. So I'm going to keep going for a little bit. Let me know how you guys are doing in the chat. If you're having fun, we'll do it for a little bit longer. So here we go. Let's draw a track. Confetti. Awesome. Okay. This is Guardian 5 from Glenn B. And it's levels passionate. Track status is advanced mix. Let's see. So the song's called Guardian. We just put out a video of Joe Ciccarelli mixing a song called Guardian from Alanis Morissette. I don't know if that's this Guardian, but we're going to find out if YouTube shuts us down. So here we go. I muted my mic on purpose, though. It's Alanis Morissette. Awesome. Cool. Great job, Glenn B. And yeah, that was Alanis Morissette, Guardian. You guys can check out that tutorial on pureMix. Joe Ciccarelli, he's amazing. And you can download the multi-track and mix it for yourself, just like this, which is super cool. Real quick, there's a storm going on outside, and my lights just flickered on me, so fingers crossed that we don't lose power. But, yeah, so a couple notes on this. Leading up to, I think it's our second chorus, the kick changes in the second chorus. So leading up to that, I felt like the bass guitar was completely eating the kick. It's a really, really woofy kind of bass sound that you have going. And what's happening down in the bottom of the track, there's a couple things that kind of tell me you might not be hearing the bottom of the track very well. That could, like, low end is our biggest enemy in rooms and everything, and it's hard to get even on headphones and all that. So it'd be something to check out. The kick feels like it doesn't have any punch to me leading up to that second chorus, and the bass feels really huge. So I just kind of check out the relationship between those two things and see if there's some things you could play with like EQ and balance to just try to make room for each of them within each other. The right guitar was jumping out in front of the vocal to me on the choruses. Again, just kind of like saying, I'm more important than Alanis. And like, I love that image of the guitar player just stepping in front of the singer, like not even next to the singer, but just in front of the singer on stage. Just something to watch out for, like, you know, making sure that Alanis is her awesome self right in the center and, you know, right in front of you where she needs to be for that style of music too. The snare feels a bit woofy to me. It's pretty beefy in the low end. There's not a lot of like crack to it. And then there's even some stuff like 300, 400 that just kind of makes it feel like there's like a pillow over top of it and it needs to like, you need to pull it off. So just play with like getting a little bit more crack out of that snare, but sometimes you can get more crack out of the snare by just removing the junk down below. Not necessarily like, let me just keep cranking up, you know, 4K or whatever to add to the attack of it. So check that out. Maybe just clean up the snare a little bit. The ending line, chorus two. When chorus two kicks in, there's a big volume push in the song. I love that. It feels like you're doing the slippery fader thing of like turning up the master on the chorus for a little bit more punch, which is cool. But I think it might be too much. It really jumped out of the speakers at me. And then the kick drum change, I like that you're doing a scene change with it. I love that effect and like, you know, telling us this is the chorus now. But it felt like a huge kick drum. And again, like the low end of it was a little bit unruly, which is giving it a lower note. I'm going to quote John Paterno like probably forever, but, another thing that he like talks about a lot is like that low end sub information. And when you boost all that stuff up, you're really adding to the length of the note. And if you think about going to a live show where there's subwoofers, and if you've ever like seen a show where the engineer probably just bought those subwoofers and really wants to push them, every time the kick drum gets hit, you hear like, right? And if it's like, imagine a funk band playing, and you've got a guy who's just like cranking the kick and the subs and that note's just being drug out forever, you can completely destroy the groove of what that band is doing by basically taking his note value and stretching it out. It'd be like if the bass player was trying to play quarter notes on the bass, but you made it so that his bass could only play whole notes or something like that. So check out what's going on in the bottom of that kick drum in the chorus and just see if you can somehow tighten that up and get the low end more under control so that it's more musical inside of the package. The ending lift at the very, very tail end of the song here. I want to listen to it one more time because I think this is important. Yeah, here we go. Cool. So basically like that lift, when all of those instruments start playing that line at the end there, I want to feel that get huge and wrap around, just like in that other song where we had those background vocals that came in at the end and they were adding this really emotional moment. It's the same thing with that line. So we really want to like have one, we need room to push it, right? So you got to save some room at the end there to go up one more step from the third chorus. You know, if you like think of the producer's energy graph, you're like intro, chorus, you know, verse, chorus, slightly louder, whatever. We're doing this like stair step energy thing as we go. We need one more level to get at the end there where we're just pushing that main melody line right over the top. And I think that the guitars, the rhythm guitars that have been chugging along through the song were at the static volume, but it was still on top of that. So I'd say like just play with some automation there and see if you can make more of an event out of that last section happening. So cool. Thanks for checking out that song and downloading it and mixing it and stuff. It's awesome to hear it. Boom, boom. And a little birdie named me told me that we're going to be doing a mixing contest with that song in that multi-track pretty soon. So that'll be fun. Stay tuned. Okay. We're going to draw another track. And we've got Umphreys McGee, Crucial Taunt, clip number 3 from Smokin' Fudo. Hey, Smokin' Fudo. Says, hi, everyone. I started trying to follow the indications of the past session, but I realized I ended up with a version that's a lot different. Probably put too much low mids. Thanks. Cheers, Mirko. Cool. Let's check it out. Here we go. I think I know this band, too. I think that this is like a pretty big band and everything. Here we go. Awesome. Cool. I saw that you're in the chat, Smokin' Fudo, so hello. Thanks for submitting this. And I actually agree with some of the things that Sonic Science Lab has going on in his comments here. So first thing I heard was, in the beginning here, I'm going to play it again. Listen to the relation of the snare to the toms. Here we go. So there was some stuff going on in the main kit as we like led right into that last section, the bar right before it hits the downbeat for the next section. The toms feel really big in the beginning of it. They're really loud and in my face, and I'm, you know, they're right there. And then on that fill, I felt like I lost them a little bit, and that made the next section's downbeat not kind of jump out and be like, next section, here we go, and like push forward in that like proggy way that feels right there. So maybe, yeah, just see if there's like something you can do to make an event of that scene change. That's another thing I love is like doing scene changes between like chorus and verse or intro or whatever. The transition that leads from one piece to the next piece is, you know, it happens maybe 5 times in the song as we go from different sections, but getting those moments right can bring you a very, very long way. So it's something to just kind of always check out is like, let me listen to, you know, 2 bars before the chorus and see how it feels leading into this. That can take a mix really, really far. So, yeah, the drums do feel a little bit overcompressed. Things overall feel pretty clamped down. It's not always bad. It's, you know, it's a style and it's like, it's aggressive and intense. But I feel like it's stealing a little bit of the percussive detail from the drums at times, but there's also a lot of attack escaping through it. So, something to play with there, just how much overall compression you're using. And then also, playing around with attack release times, maybe, the lead vocal felt like there was some like 2.5k like kind of stuff that would poke out every once in a while. It's not an all the time thing. That's kind of a fun topic too, is dealing with problems that are temporary problems but giving them a permanent solution. So if the vocal's poking out once in a while at, you know, 2.5 or whatever it happens to be, if it's doing it once in a while, it doesn't mean like go in there and do like a 4 dB cut at 2.5k across the entire track. It's like maybe that's something that you just automate on those pieces, or check out what else is going on in the chain to see if, you know, it could be compressors letting go and just causing little spikes of that energy. Just seeing if there's something else that you could do to fix it first. But if not, maybe deal with it with a more temporary solution like automating an EQ. Soothe can be really great for that. Again, not necessarily globally across the entire song, but sometimes you can just pop it out of bypass for that little moment to deal with the problem. Or again, just automate an EQ on those moments. Also feels like there's a little bunching around like maybe 300-ish. So just something that's like stealing away from a little bit of the clarity of it. And then I agree with what Sonic Science Lab said as well, where it's not necessarily like a giant mix. So it's got a lot more mid-range going on. There's a lot more mid-forward. There's not like a giant bottom end to it, which is cool. And especially for that style, that feels like it's era appropriate to me too. So I kind of actually like the way that you went with it, where it doesn't feel like necessarily this big full range mix. But it is, you know, very important that you get the mid-range right if you're going to kind of go that way and say like, this is where I'm doing this with my hands, this little shape. This is where the mix is going to live. So you have to totally nail like those moments where things get harsh and bitey. You got to solve those and make it really smooth and great. But yeah, awesome job overall. And thanks for being in the chat. Cool. Let's hit the button. Here we go. Confetti. All right. State of Grace. DSH Cook. Okay. You don't have Christian music as a category, so rock it is. Awesome. Let's check this out. Here we go.
Stand with the one who made me. He's worthy of all my separate me from my father's love. Not anything in my past or present, nor anything that is yet to come. Oh, my faith reflects his mercy, and my hope knows no bounds. And every day, little by little, and inch by inch, I'm coming up on higher ground. So I stand with the one who made me. I'll speak of his love every single day. I've surrendered state of grace. I'm in a state of grace. With my God, I will rise above. Nothing is impossible, nothing is too tough. In Christ alone, I shall overcome. Speak of his love every single day. I've surrendered my all to the one who saved me. I'd lay down my life for me to die is gain. I'm in a state of grace. I'm in a state of grace. I'm in a state of
awesome. Actually, let's do that one more time. Here, check this out. Okay, so great job. Awesome. And yeah, thanks for submitting this. Great work. Nice song if you worked on it and wrote it too. Yeah. Really, really cool. There's some really neat things going on and some things that we could look at. These things are hard because it's giving feedback to be useful, but there's a lot of great things going on all the time too. So I just want to preface that and, you know, a little bit of a disclaimer there, but great work on putting it all together. So in the beginning, why I went back and hit that again, I was listening to the reverb tail that's on that snare, and going back to some of the songs that we heard earlier with the sampled toms where the note value is super long, it might be worth checking out the reverb time on the snare. It's style appropriate, the big hall thing on it, but I'm wondering if you could tighten it just a little bit and shorten the time, maybe even clean up some of the bottom or the low mids of that, just to get out of the way again of the next note that's coming in. So it feels like it's a half note decay or something like that, but just kind of making sure that by the time that we get to the next bar, the next beat, that note has kind of finished. So everything that we do with reverb and time-based effects and all that is, it's adding note values and all that. So you have to remember that these are musical decisions that can really affect what's going on with the groove of a song and all of that. It's awesome in a way, like when people say, oh, that's really musical. That's a great example of that. It's like the reverb was timed to be musical. It doesn't have to be perfect. And sometimes being sloppy is the way to go or whatever, like letting it go over. But if it's stealing clarity or like stealing away from the pocket, then it's something that you can check out. Yeah, so I wouldn't go ultra short because again, it's like style appropriate and all that. But that was one thing that kind of jumped out to me right off the bat. The toms, one thing to check out with those, the balance of the toms in relation to each other and the rest of the kit is something you could check out. I felt like they were super wide. So the left rack tom was hitting really far left to me and then very loud as well. So it was like popping out of the speaker. And then as it went down the kit, it felt like, I guess in relation to you, so it'd be, this is the left? Yeah. Here's like the left tom. And then as it went down in that fill, it was like doing one of these things where it was getting quieter and moving away from me and then going kind of down or whatever. So I would just take a listen and like listen with some intention about where those toms are. If you're going for a natural thing or if you want the big animated tom thing, I think you're going for the big animated tom thing, which is awesome. And making those an event is really cool. But having them at that point when the rack tom hit, it was the loudest thing in the mix, which once again pulled me away from the song and away from the message of, you know, what's coming down the lyric and everything. And it's like tom fill, you know. So if you've ever seen like Up where the dog is like squirrel, that's how I felt. It was like tom or whatever. So always listening for that kind of stuff. The low end of the track feels very washy and phasey to me. So I don't know if there's some phase stuff going on. Like if, I don't know if this came to you or how it might've come in or what might've happened, but it felt like it was kind of out of phase and everything was kind of like spread out across the bottom of it, which would really mess with like mono compatibility on things. I think I saw like somebody might've commented on that too in the live chat. But yeah, just take a look at the kick and the bass. And again, like the bottom is something that's really, really hard to hear in every room and to get right. So it might just be worth checking it out. You are a pureMix Pro member, so you have access to Decibel. If you don't know anything about it, go to process.audio/decibel and you can download that as a part of your subscription. And there's some tools in there. There's a phase scope that can kind of tell you about some problems that are happening. If you can't hear them that well in your monitoring environment, sometimes a quick glance at the meter will tell you like, hey, things are getting kind of crazy down in the bottom. Ears better than eyes, but, it can be a useful tool. So there are, some moments with the vocals that were a little bit painful. And this felt like more of a global solution need than the last track where it was like just once in a while. So you might want to just check out like what's going on in the upper mid range with the vocal. It felt like it gets a little bit screechy at times, and there might be some things that you can do to just kind of tame that. Again, like Soothe 2 is a really useful tool for that kind of stuff. But ultimately first, just looking at the processing that you have going on, making sure that the issue or the thing that you want to address is actually in the source track and it's not something that you're adding unintentionally or whatever before you use something like Soothe to, you know, kind of go in with like the heavy hacksaw and like start chopping stuff out of the signal. So so check out that. Same thing kind of in the cymbals. I felt like there was like maybe some 4K stuff that every time there would be a crash, it would just kind of come out and zing my ear a little bit. So just look for things that are jumping out, making the mix less pleasant to listen to. AirPods are really good for that. Like they'll really get nasty pretty quick a lot of times. and they can actually be really useful for figuring out some of that upper mid-range stuff if you have monitors that aren't really telling you, if your headphones aren't telling you or whatever. Sometimes like smaller AirPods can help out with it. There's some background vocals that come in toward the end of the song. There's also like an artificial synthetic choir thing that happens. So the backgrounds before that happened, I want to say it's around 3 minutes-ish. I wanted to hear those and have them come forward. So just find a way to make some room for those. That can be automation, bringing the guitars down on the sides, or, you know, doing whatever you need to do to make some room for them. And then the synthetic choir came in and it said, "I'm more important than everybody." And it was like a guy with a keytar came out in front of the lead singer and the other singer and like nailed the synthetic choir. So this is, again, just a moment of like, what's the most important thing that's happening in this section? There's an awesome synth choir that comes in here, and that's going to add to my production and everything, but is it more important than the lead vocal right now? So with that in mind, kind of saying, okay, if the lead vocal lives here, maybe the synth choir lives in front of the guitars because I want it to be there and that's my intention, but not necessarily in front of the lead vocal there. You know, because if you're the listener hearing this for the first time, for especially like for the like target audience and the purpose of the music, the synth choir is not what's going to give somebody an experience in that moment and everything. And better to just let the vocal and the message do it. But everything's taste, and if that's what you wanted to do, then awesome. That's great. The guitar solo felt like it was a little bit compressed and could maybe use a little bit of width or space on it. So it was very like mono up the center. There might be something you can do to just kind of like, again, make that more of an event as well. Like, you know, a little bit of extra space around it. In this genre, like doing the dotted eighth, 16th thing, or like the edge style delays around the guitar to kind of build up can be a thing. The guitar solo wasn't really that style, but some sort of delays around it might be something that adds a little bit of width to it. Just again, make sure that it's musical. And then at the end, I thought it could benefit from a little bit of vocal tuning. So some things got a little bit loose. I wasn't really listening for pitch either, but like the pitch didn't jump out to me until we got to the end. That was when I was like, oh, there might be some pitch things with the vocal. So again, you get Melodyne Essential with your pro membership. So maybe just check it out and do a little bit of a tuning pass there and see if you can tighten things up. Thanks so much for submitting it. I hope that's useful. And again, great job putting it together. That's great. So let me put this here. I'll just say I'm pasting the link this time, given the context of the song. Okay, cool. Awesome. Thanks again, DSH Cook. Let's draw a track. Let's see. It's like 4 o'clock. Maybe I'll hit one more, see how everybody's doing. And yeah, let's do it. So yeah, we'll hit one more for today. Thank you guys so much for tuning in too. Again, we'll be here every week, 2:30 p.m. And yeah, we'll keep doing this. So if I didn't get to your mix today, I'm very sorry. We'll hit it on the next one for sure. And thanks for, you know, working with me at the beginning a little bit when I was giving you sign language too. First time doing it. There's a lot going on. So 14-year-olds on Twitch are way better than I am at this, for sure. But okay, I'm gonna hit draw a track. Here we go. All right, we've got Happiness, and there's his email. So everybody make sure that you send him an email and tell him awesome job. Happiness, this is from Ryan Mondock, and this is an early mix. It says, "Here's a track I produced and recorded. Let me know what you think I can improve on mix-wise." Okay, let's check it out. Here we go, guys.
I swear to God, I've been thinking lately. It's not new for me to feel crazy. He laughs it up, says I'm not the only one. Then I'm out the door, so I wonder what the hell is wrong. It's in my head like a memory. God knows if I'll find some kind of peace, so I'll try. Is it just the season? Blame it on another one leaving. Never mind the second guessing. It don't care, last night's depression. It's in my head like a
Ryan, that's awesome. Nice job. Great work. I love this track. Great production too. There's I love like the mono string thing that kind of comes out on the left toward the end there. That feels great. Man, so much of that feels awesome. Great job. I enjoyed the song, and yeah, that was a pleasure to listen to too. So thanks for submitting this. This is great. I'm gonna just jump right in. The kick drum feels awesome and punchy, but very loud. It's kind of like stepping out in front of everybody, stepping in front of that bass a little bit. And there were moments where it would get kind of quiet and then jump out again. And so there's a little bit of a dynamics thing happening in there too. The bass relationship is just something to kind of check out in there. But overall, it felt really good. It just felt like the kick was a little bit too far forward to me, but it's, you know, taste as well. Around 126, I felt like the high notes got soaked up a little bit. Like there was some overcompression happening in the vocal, which was adding a little bit of boxiness, I think. It just something to play with. And we'll go over to 126 to check it out, actually. Let me see if I have something more to say about that. Here we go.
It don't care, last night's depression. It's in my head like a sin. It don't care, last night's depression.
So it sounds like a vocalist pulling away from the microphone to hit the big note and then coming closer, but if she's hitting a note that high, unless she's, you know, kind of doing it to get pitch or something, she's not really producing more volume. So I don't know. And then the volume rise after it felt like a compressor letting go a little bit to me, but it could just be that it was some mic movement. So something to check out the vocal compression, just see if there's, if it's stealing any tone from you at all. Like if you bypass and listen to that vocal, if it feels better to you, obviously volume compensate, but on moments like this, if you're happy with how everything's working too, I would use some automation to smooth that transition over. So just one more time on it.
It don't care, last night's depression. It's in my...
Yeah, so it's okay, gets really small, and then last night's depression comes up and gets louder on there. If you need me to re-sing the vocal, give me a call. Okay, only because I sang that note. Okay, and then let's see what else I had here. So the long high notes that happen toward the end, there's a synth that inspired this thought, but there's a synth with some delay on it that's happening. It's like slightly left a little bit. Feels awesome. It's like a classic, like feeling sine wavy kind of synth thing that's happening, but it's got some delays on it, which feels awesome in the style and like the space of this mix. And as she would do the long held out try, when she was singing the word try that was long and held out, I would have loved to hear some effects kind of bloom around her voice and possibly even push her back in the mix a little bit, like doing that thing. So like automating up a little bit of space around it, not throwing her down a canyon, but just laying into that space that synth had already created might feel pretty cool. Just like an idea. The snare, I felt like that could be maybe a little bit more present and come forward. That's also in relation to how the piano is feeling. Like the piano feels like it's jumping out a little bit at moments and getting in front of the vocal as well. So again, when like things are kind of randomly doing that, it makes me like start thinking over compression, and you can kind of hear like the clamping going down. So maybe just check out some things that are going on with the two bus around individual tracks with that, and see if loosening things up would make it a little bit more natural and give you more space in the canvas to play with too. But yeah, man, that was a pleasure to listen to. I really enjoyed it, and thanks for submitting it. So cool. Yeah, you guys are awesome in the chat. Cool. So yeah, I think that's gonna wrap us up for today. And if I didn't get to you today, please check in next week. We'll be back 2:30 p.m. Eastern. And yeah, we'll have some exciting news coming for you about mixing contests with the song, the Alanis Morissette song that you heard earlier, mixed by Joe Ciccarelli. And we should have some more video announcements for you guys next week and some other fun stuff on the horizon. So thanks again so much for tuning in and watching and submitting your mixes. There's some, as always, there's amazing stuff on here. These are always really fun because it's like an hour of amazing music, and just seeing what the community is up to is really great. So thank you guys for subscribing. Thank you for watching on YouTube and Twitch and Facebook and everywhere else that we're at. If you, again, if you're not a pureMix Pro member, you can head over to puremix.net and hit Mixtank. You can join up to the site and then submit your track to get feedback from the entire community and from myself every Monday at 2:30 Eastern. So cool. We'll see you guys next time. Thanks again.